Hello, Rise Church family. Welcome to this online version of our Saturday evening service. I'm pleased that you could join us tonight, and we're going to begin, as we have done in the several weeks previous to this, by turning our hearts to the Lord in worship. Won't you join me?
Jesus, you're everything, Jesus. eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, so this heart brings you glory. So this heart brings you glory. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, so my heart brings you glory. My heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, so this heart brings you glory. So this heart brings you glory. Eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, so this heart brings you glory. For you alone are holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy. Power and love as we heart bring you glory.
I want to thank our worship leaders again, between Johnny and Shauna and Sarah and Kirk. We literally haven't missed a beat in terms of our worship. And one of the things that's so interesting is that when I ask people for their response to our online services, it's almost without fail that the very first thing out of their mouth is, I love the worship. Rise Church is a worshiping church. We have a very long history of offering ourselves and our praise, our worship to Jesus, and I'm proud of that. I'm glad for that. It's an important spiritual discipline that we engage in, and we're really grateful to all the folks who have been involved in providing that for us, both when we're back at the church and now when we're in this sequestered version of living. You know, besides being a worshiping church, Rise Church is also a giving church. In about 2 weeks, we're going to get our next official financial report from the bookkeeper, but just this past Tuesday, the elders were meeting and we looked at the preliminary numbers, and we were very delighted to see that we've kind of remained very steady in our giving over the last month. It may not be at the level that we saw before the orders were given for us to stay at home, but given the circumstances, we would still wholeheartedly say that Rise Church is a giving church. And so thanks to all of you who are giving. We appreciate your generosity and your faithfulness to our church and its ministries. And if you want an easy way to give, you can go to our webpage, riselh.com, and follow the links to get to the giving section of our website. And there you will find instructions on how to give electronically. One of the things we appreciate is all of you who have signed up to give electronically, to use that kind of a method to get your gifts to us. Thanks so much. It makes it easy, and blessings to you. If you were with us last week, you might recall that we had our first Body Life segment online. April Albrecht was with us, and she did just really a terrific job encouraging us to share our faith in these days when people are out of their normal rhythm. Many of them may just be thinking about their eternity. And though we don't have a Body Life segment for tonight, I just wanted to express the thought that, you know what, if God has been doing something marvelous in your life during this time that we've been apart, or if you've seen ministry within the body, somebody has ministered to you, or you've had the chance to meet somebody's need, or even if you've had an opportunity to share your faith with a neighbor that you happen to see driving down the street, anything like that, any testimony of the way that God's working, we would love to know about that. And so if you've got a story to tell, call the church office, let us know that you've got something, and we can set up a little appointment to call and talk about that story to see if maybe in one of our upcoming Saturday night services, whether it's online or back at the building, that we could fit that in nicely with the theme of the evening. So tonight we're going to continue our teaching series entitled Finding Joy in the Midst of Trouble. In fact, tonight we're going to finish the first chapter of the book of Philippians. And so that puts us one quarter of the way through that book. Don't forget that you can hear any message in this series that you might have missed or you want to hear it again, just simply by visiting our YouTube channel at Rise Church La Habra. And while you're there, subscribe so that you won't miss a single thing that we're broadcasting. You know, our nation is at a turning point as we live out our lives in light of the COVID-19 pandemic. You know, if you went backwards for a minute and think about the timeline that we've experienced over the last couple of months, it goes something like this. About 2.5 months ago, we were living life as usual, in spite of some unsettling news coming out of China about a particularly nasty virus that was spreading quite quickly. So quickly that the country was forced to erect new hospitals to care for the increasing numbers of people who were in desperate need of medical attention from this respiratory demon. Then sometime along mid-March, this uninvited guest began showing up in our country. And fear and caution led our leaders to take what seems like a very unprecedented step. The life was shut down. We were instructed to cocoon ourselves off from one another behind closed doors and behind our computer screens and behind masks and gloves. And now in the last week or so, there's been a lot of talk about, you know, should we open things up again? And if so, how should we do that? And when should we do that? All of that kind of talk is very different than what we've heard over the last number of weeks. It's obvious that we've reached a turning point in the progress of this pandemic. I guess we could say the curve has been flattened. Hospitals now have fairly adequate supplies to deal with situations that are arising. And people, let's face it, are anxious to come out of hiding. They want to get back to work. They want to get back to the beach. They want to get back to something that feels like normal in their lives. It's a significant turning point. It's fitting that we are in that particular place in our society because, in reality, as we go back to the book of Philippians, we're going to find that tonight we're going to look at another turning point. The Apostle Paul has finished his introductory comments. He has laid a nice theological foundation for what he wants to say next. If you've read any of the Apostle Paul extensively, I should say, you realize that his common practice is to teach about doctrine and then to begin to relate practical principles of application to our lives based on that doctrine. And so in light of some very important truths about God and our relationship with him, now he's going to move to the idea of how we should now live. Now, for some people, you might be happy to get to the practical aspects of living out a Christian life. I mean, those people think that doctrine can be boring. Maybe they think it's relatively unimportant, that it's an unnecessary introduction to anything that Paul would say, kind of the meat and potatoes practical application of what it is that it means to live out the Christian life. And so there are people who would say, okay, already, Paul, enough with the doctrine. Just tell me what it is that I need to do. How should I live? Now, just to make the point, you know, the problem with that kind of emphasis on just the pragmatic or just on the practical is that if Paul only told you what to do, that is how to live, you end up having a very weak foundation underneath your practical experience in life. I mean, we might know the what or the how, but really, if it's going to be a solid transformation, we need to know the why. I mean, Paul could have just started out this whole book by simply saying, hey, folks, be joyful. But let's face it, that's a pretty difficult thing to do when life is hard, when it seems like things around you are falling apart. I mean, for the Apostle Paul, when you find yourself arrested, you find yourself in prison, you find yourself shackled to a Roman guard, you find yourself waiting for the obviously mentally unbalanced leader of your country to determine your, you know, fate, the circumstances make it very difficult to be joyful. In the same token, for Paul, being separated from the church that he loves, the deep relationships that he has established with those people, the lives he has touched, the influence he has had, the results he has seen, all of that was so wonderful that it's kind of hard to be joyful now when all of that's been stripped away. I mean, and on top of that, for Paul, when he watches people with impure motives moving into the church and into relationship with some of his friends, and they begin taking advantage of his friends for their own self-centered purposes, it's really hard to find joy when you're angry about what's going on, or when you're frightened for your friends and you care about their ultimate well-being. Just because someone tells us, be joyful, we know that it's hard to manufacture joy when the circumstances of life are anything but joyful. But Paul found joy. He had found that in spite of his circumstances, he could have a deep sense of joy, a sense that all was well. That joy, though, was based on his understanding of God, not his circumstances. That joy was really doctrinal in its basis. And so, yes, he's going to get to the place of talking more about joy, but we have to have that underlayment, that foundation of solid doctrine. And so what we've seen throughout the majority of the first chapter in Philippians is that Paul knew that in order to have joy, there were a few things that we all need to have solidly in place in terms of our doctrine. The first of those is that we need to understand very clearly that this God who began this good work in us is not finished with us yet. And that in reality, he's using these circumstances in our lives to bring about good things in our own individual lives. Another thing Paul wants us to grasp is that this God is actually using the circumstances not only in Paul's best interest, but to advance God's kingdom in the world. As Paul describes it in the first chapter, to make progress with the gospel. And then there's the third thing, that whether Paul lived or died, it didn't matter. We saw this last week. If he lived and got to continue to walk with Jesus and serve the church and be in relationship with his beloved friends, great. If he died, even better, because he would immediately find himself in the presence of Jesus. Because for Paul, life was all about Jesus. So Paul had these deep theological, doctrinal sorts of understandings that rooted this joy that bubbled up onto the surface of his life in spite of the circumstances. And we understand that we have to have that, that without that foundation, there could really not have been any joy for Paul. And the same is true for us. As long as we've got those doctrinal things in place, then whatever we see around us that might be threatening, that it might stir up fear in our hearts, we'll be able to discover exactly what Paul discovered, and that was joy. He wanted his friends to find joy in the midst of their trials, no matter what they were. And so first he lays out this doctrinal foundation, and now he's coming to a turning point. It's in light of those truths that he's shared about God and God's work in his life, how God's continuing to use him to advance the gospel in the midst of these awful circumstances, knowing that life and death doesn't matter which one of those takes place because it's all within God's economy. What he's now going to do is he's going to turn from those doctrinal things and begin to give us some practical exhortations. Understand that all of this is very much the same for us. Firmly rooted in doctrine, will yield that fruit of joy as we go about living our Christian lives. And Paul's going to share with us what it is that we need to do to live out this life. So Paul begins then with a very broad and a very general encouragement to his friends. Based on what I've just told you, he says, what I've told you about God and how God is working, in us and through us, from that, let me give you this encouragement, this practical idea about how to live your life. And so he tells them, do this. He says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Now, this is certainly one of the most common themes in all of the writings of the Apostle Paul. I mean, when he starts encouraging the saints in a variety of churches in how to live, this idea of living in a manner worthy of the gospel is an often repeated encouragement. One particular author summarized up this idea by saying this, this mandate is expressed elsewhere in the New Testament as walking in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called. That's Ephesians 4. Or in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. That's Colossians 1. In another place, in 1 Thessalonians, Paul says it this way, I want you to walk in a manner worthy of the God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. And so here we have Paul to the Ephesians and to the Colossians and to the Thessalonians, all churches, and then to the Philippians here. He's essentially saying the very same thing to all of them. Walk in a worthy manner. We could add our own church in there. To Rise Church, he says, walk in a manner worthy of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, The word that Paul uses here in Philippians is actually a very instructive word, but it's not often used. The root of the word is the word polis. It means city. And if you look at that word, polis, you begin to see that words that we understand, like politics or political, those are all embedded in there. Scholars, you know, remind us that in the Greek system of city-states and then in the Roman colonies, there was a very high value on the citizens of these locations demonstrating their allegiance to the political body to which they belonged. I like how one person said it, that a responsible citizen was careful not to do anything that would bring disrepute on his polis. And he tried always to be considered an honorable citizen, so that he would never be removed from the list of citizens. So there were benefits that the polis offered to the citizen, and in return, it was expected that the citizen of the polis would act in ways that reflected well upon his polis. It's really the same idea that Paul is trying to communicate here. He's calling the people in the church at Philippi to live in ways that would reflect well on the kingdom of God, in ways that would highlight the gospel of Jesus Christ, and obviously not in ways that would be detrimental to the kingdom or to the people's understanding of the gospel. So in other words, it should be obvious by the ways that we live that we belong to the kingdom of God. We bear the marks of a citizen of heaven. We speak like a follower of Christ. We act like a follower of Christ. We conduct ourselves in a manner that brings no shame or disrepute to Jesus. Now, friends, that's a high calling. But it is our calling to never live in any way that would cause people to doubt that the gospel of Christ has changed our lives. I mean, it should be obvious just by looking at us that there's something different about us. We're not just like everyone else. There's something unique, something attractive, something winsome about us. People who watch us should be able to tell just by listening to us or seeing how we behave that we're Christians, that we've been changed, that we're part of the kingdom, that the gospel has transformed our lives. Now, this idea is really a very broad and general idea, this idea of, you know, living and walking in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus. But in some ways, it's so broad and general that maybe we're still wanting a few more specifics. In other words, okay, it's great to say, hey, let's live in a manner worthy of the gospel. But then it's another question to say, what does that really mean? I mean, what does it look like to conduct ourselves in a manner that's worthy of the gospel? What do we do or not do that represents Jesus and his kingdom most appropriately? And so as this first chapter comes to a close, Paul's going to give us four ideas, four specifics, if you will, of what it looks like to walk in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul says it this way: only conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that you are standing firm. That's going to be the first point we're going to make, that Paul is going to say, if you're really living in a manner that's worthy of the gospel, you're standing firm. But let me point out something first. You notice that Paul is not talking about some kind of internal change that has occurred in our lives, something that really can't be seen from the outside. He's really talking about ways that we live that can be seen. You notice that he said, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you. You see, he's really talking about evidence, isn't he? Either firsthand evidence that he's going to have that the Philippians are still walking in a manner worthy of the gospel, or through people that come to Rome and visit him, he's going to hear from them about the outstanding qualities, the great characteristics that these people are exhibiting that prove that they've been transformed, that Jesus has made a difference in their life. In other words, you can't just say you're a Christian and not demonstrate it in your actions. We need to live in such a way that it's obvious to anyone who comes in contact with us, that they'll see that we're different. And anyone who hears about us, they will hear about how Jesus has changed us, whether they see it firsthand or not. And so Paul's talking about observable patterns of living that set us apart as belonging to Jesus. I mean, the way we walk and the way we talk are obviously influenced by our faith in Jesus. That would be the testimony that we're looking for. And so those four characteristics, here's the first. The first is the characteristic that we would be people who stand firm. The idea is pretty simple, isn't it? That we hold our ground regardless of the danger that we face, or the opposition that we encounter, or the circumstances that come to bear upon our lives. We will not be swayed. We will not be moved. We will not change our story. We will not be one way with a certain group of people and then another way with another group of people. Standing firm simply means that we know what we believe, we know who we believe in, and we are unwavering in that belief. Now, someone may oppose our faith, but we remain stable. Someone may threaten us, even with death, but we remain steadfast. I mean, if you look through the annals of history, you find it filled with people who have died as martyrs for their faith. The early apostles, you recall, were arrested. Many were told to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. They didn't. They were beaten, they were stoned, they were killed, but they stood firm. And that's part of what made such a great impact on the world around them. They were unflinching in their faith. Martin Luther, later in history, was condemned by a church council, and he was told to recant his beliefs. He refused, and he lived out the rest of his days in hiding, being pursued by people who were literally seeking to kill him. I have a pastor friend in Africa who's writing to me, telling me of how fellow Christians there in these days of this pandemic are in danger for their lives. And it just feeds into this conflict that's already there between other religions and the Christians. But because of the fear or because of circumstances, so many of our brothers and sisters there, they're not backing down. They're not shying away. What they're doing is they're standing firm. Many have died, but they've died holding strong to their faiths. Now, don't think that we won't face these kinds of situations. I was really disturbed just a few weeks ago when a major newspaper ran an op-ed piece from a writer who said that the spread of the COVID-19 virus should be blamed on Christians. Christians who continue to meet in spite of the federal and state injunctions to stop meeting. And so really, regardless of how you might feel about a church that's still meeting in spite of the prohibitions, whether they should do so in the interest of public health or not, you realize, don't you, the impact of a journalist in a major newspaper declaring that Christians are to blame for the spread of this disease. Wow, it starts to sound an awful lot like the way that the Nazis began, you know, their Holocaust, deciding who it was that was to blame and then moving to eliminate them. Don't think that persecution will pass us by. Jesus, in fact, told us quite point blank, expect persecution. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you as well. We are apt to suffer for our faith. And so the question is, will we bow our knee? Will we take a path of least resistance? Will we change our tune? Or will we, as Paul is encouraging us here, will we stand firm? As some have pointed out, standing firm has kind of a two-edged sword approach to it. It means both to stand firm against opposition, but it's also standing firm for the gospel. If we buy into this very common idea that we should just let people believe what they want to believe, and that all roads lead to heaven, and that Jesus is not the only way to God, let's just live and let live, people say. But friends, you know what? That's really not standing firm for Jesus. In love, be sure, in love, we need to be strong in declaring that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We don't bow, we don't succumb to some kind of watered-down gospel. We stand firm in the fact that we believe that Jesus is the answer, that our Lord died for our sins in order that we could have life eternal. I mean, we realize that's how Paul lived. I mean, he might die for his faith, but he would die standing firm for Jesus. And it was his standing firm that set him apart. We saw this earlier, that it was the fact that he was so bold and courageous and standing firm and continuing to share the gospel even in the midst of difficult circumstances. It was that characteristic of Paul that caused others to take notice of him. And in fact, it's what emboldened others to themselves stand firm in spite of their own opposition and their own persecution and their own difficult circumstances. We're called to do the same thing. To walk worthy of the gospel is to be a person who stands firm, standing firm against opposition and standing firm for the gospel and our Lord. The second characteristic that Paul mentions is that if we're going to be people who walk in a manner worthy of the gospel, then we need to be people who demonstrate unity. Paul says it this way in the text. He says, standing firm in, catch it, one spirit with, catch it, one mind. You see the repetition again. One spirit, one mind. What he's saying is that unity is essential. The idea is here is pretty simple. I mean, the church, no matter what age you want to talk about, is a very diverse group of people that have one thing that ties them together. We all have faith in Jesus Christ. I mean, you look at the world that we live in, our world is horribly fractured. We saw it before the pandemic, and I pretty much guarantee you we're going to see it after the pandemic. It's a world that's fractured by different worldviews, different political ideologies, different values, different religions, different economic levels. And the church is no different. The church is made up of people from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. And with all of their differences, they come together. But what makes them different and sets them apart is that they find commonality. We all have faith in Jesus Christ. And so when we live in ways that foster and promote that kind of unity, that's what it means to be living in a manner worthy of the gospel. I mean, when we do things then that break that unity, we're not living in a manner worthy of the gospel, no matter what we say. The gospel is what brings people together. And as a result of that, to walk in a manner worthy of the gospel that brings people together means that we have to demonstrate that. I mean, you remember Jesus told his disciples in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, he says this, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." It's our love, it's our unity that makes us easily identifiable as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. It's our unity that sets us apart from every other group of people on the face of the planet. It's our unity that demonstrates to a watching world that we are people who are Christ's family. We're walking in a manner worthy of the gospel. The third characteristic that Paul gives us is that if we're living in a manner worthy of the gospel, then we're going to strive together. You might even say we're going to fight together. Paul says it this way in verse 27. He talks about us standing firm in one spirit with one mind, and catch it, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Yeah, you notice I didn't say fighting with one another or striving with one another, but fighting together, striving together. The language Paul's using here is that of an athletic contest. It's the idea of a team working together. And each member of the team brings their own abilities and their own strengths. And they marshal all of their resources and their uniquenesses and their differences, all for a common goal. You know, in sports, it's to get the ball over the goal line or get the ball into the hoop. You know, if you're talking about, you know, track and field, it's runners who are running in a relay race, and each has their own specialty, and each is doing their part, and so they pass the baton from one to the next participant, all working together, striving together to win the race. That's exactly the picture Paul's trying to paint here. He's thinking about our differences and our unity, but it's got to be more than that. That unity, it can't be just we sit back and we, you know, hug and love each other, as fine as that is. What he's talking about is that we begin to understand that together, we move together in unity, but we have a goal. There's a point to it. There's a purpose in it. And the purpose of that is that we're going to strive together. We're going to fight together in this great kingdom conflict that we're part of. Now, sadly, what I see around us is that we have lots of things that we like to disagree about. We have many things that we separate over. I mean, in the old days, it used to be, the battle lines were drawn over which version of the Bible you used. I mean, we fought with each other over, you know, whether we were a King James only person or if we would allow the New American Standard or the New International Version. I think we've pretty much moved on beyond that, at this point in time. But still, we see signs and places where instead of striving together for the gospel, we separate. I know, for instance, of a very large and influential church that absolutely for decades refused to participate with the Billy Graham Crusades. Why? Because Billy Graham would often have leaders of different denominations on the platform with him. And so, in fighting with one another, we went the way of the world. We went in the wrong direction. Everyone in the world fights with one another. Where's the church that strives with one another for the common goal of advancing the kingdom by proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ? So that was the third. We're going to strive together for the gospel. And the fourth, the final, is Paul encourages us to live fearless lives. People who are walking in a manner worthy of the gospel are those that live fearless lives. Look what he says in verse 28. He says, "In no way alarmed by your opponents, which is a sign of destruction for them, but of salvation for you, and that too from God." The word alarmed that he uses here is really a picture of a horse that shies away from something that frightens it. Maybe it's a snake in the path or a fire in the barn or a fence that looks too high to jump over. The horse is afraid, and so it alters its course. It shies away. It backs up. Not so those who are faithful citizens of heaven. They are fearless. In spite of the obstacles that they face, in spite of the opposition that they face, these people that Paul's talking about, when they're faced with several forms of trials and trouble, it doesn't matter. It doesn't make them change their course. It doesn't make them shy away or back down. Instead, they live fearlessly in the face of their awful circumstances. I mean, we mentioned this before, that the church in Philippi had, troubles of their own. They had persecution from outside the church, most certainly. A government that was hostile to them, people that were hostile towards them. And they had troubles from within. There were wolves in sheep's clothing that were causing chaos and division in the church. Contrary doctrines and beliefs. As Paul says in the final verses of this chapter, he says, "For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me and now here to be in me." See, Paul faced trouble from outside. He faced trouble from within. I mean, his situation was one of life and death. So I think it would count that his troubles were big enough to strike fear into his heart. And so it was for the people in the church at Philippi. So it is for us. Many of the circumstances around us are enough to cause fear, big enough to strike fear in our hearts. But you see, the person who is walking in a manner worthy of the gospel is fearless in the face of their troubles. They are a person who is noticeably different than others. Their faith carries them through the trials and the difficulties. And when we stand firm, facing our troubles fearlessly, it spells two things that Paul talks about. When we are fearless in the face of those who oppose us, it spells destruction for them. You see, when we refuse to bow, when we refuse to turn and run, to shy away like that horse, we gain the victory. And theirs, then, is the defeat and the destruction. For us, our fearless facing of our trials also spells salvation for us. Because that fearlessness is proof that we're children of the King. It proves that we are individuals who are being saved by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said it this way. He says, "Behold, an hour is coming, and has already come, for you to be scattered, each to his own home, and to leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me." He says, "These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage." He says, "Be fearless. I have overcome the world." Jesus faced the worst, and he did so fearlessly. His children are also empowered to face their times of trouble fearlessly. And when we do, the world sits up and takes notice. It's drawn to the life-changing power of Jesus Christ. And so how are we doing? Are we living in a manner worthy of the gospel that we proclaim? Are we standing firm? Are we unified? Are we striving together for the gospel? And in doing that, fearlessly facing whatever opposition, whatever troubles it is that we encounter. Now, we all know that no one lives this way perfectly. It is, though, the place that the Lord is taking us. And so my encouragement to all of us this week is let's seek the Lord this week to live in a way that demonstrates, that proves beyond a shadow of a doubt, that we are citizens of heaven, children of God, followers of Jesus. Let's walk in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus. Let's pray. And so, Father, we ask that you would empower us and embolden us to be people whose lives are so different because you are changing us and transforming us to be people who walk in a manner worthy of the gospel. Lord, that we would be those people that stand firm, that we would be people that are unified And in that unity, Lord, we wouldn't just be sitting enjoying our unity, but that we'd be striving together, fighting together, as it were, for the gospel and for the kingdom of God. And that, Lord, as we enter into that engagement, that we would do so fearlessly, because we know who's with us.